Alors plus rien ne se laisse oublier.
So I think right now we have waited 3 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, and those people are still coming. Somewhere. Let's wait. 5 past 1.
Then for 1 minute, everyone can enjoy the opening slide.
Yeah.
Also. I did turn off the music by switching to my screen, so if any one of you feels free to sing a song, then I go ahead.
Well, let me take my moment then. No, I won't do that to you.
Cool.
Can you also maximize your screen, Barry?
That's a good one.
Or share, or just present it.
Present. Don't use the present mode that often. Present.
All the way on the right, yeah.
Right hand side, yeah. Okay.
Excellent.
So, I think we can start slowly because we have spent 5 minutes for waiting. So let me start with some introductions and welcoming. And good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our second online Agile Talks today. I hope that you and your loved ones are all safe and healthy nowadays. And this is Melike Akşahin speaking from Agile Turkey team, and I will be your host for the first session of this event. So I would like to first start thanking you for being with us this good afternoon, this sunny afternoon. Actually, it starts to become a little bit cloudy now. So this is very exciting for me and for my Agile Turkey friends, because we will be hosting very precious speakers whom I will introduce a couple of minutes later. And we also have a surprise here today. And before doing that, I would like to start with some housekeeping first before diving into the context. So since the Zoom bombers are very common nowadays, we have some security actions today. So for security reasons, we kindly request from all of our participants to rename their screen name or their display name as their name and surnames. And today, all of our participants will be muted by default by the host. So during the event, if you would like to ask questions, we will use the Slido application. And my friends in Agile Turkey team will be sharing the Slido link and the corresponding hashtag with you via chat soon. And as we announced in the meetup, this event will be recorded during the whole day, and it will be shared after the event in the YouTube, so that you can reach the content if you would like to re-listen or share the content with your friends. And after completing our housekeeping, I can't wait to show you our surprise and introduce our guests to you and go over the agenda today. So today, Barry and his surprise guests will be with us. And after that, Leonor will be with us. I will be the host for the Barry's session today, and my beloved friend Esra will be the host for Leonor's session. And in between, we will have a networking session in which we will be, all the participants will be disbanded to Zoom breakout rooms for knowing each other a little bit better and sharing experiences. I think it will take like 10 or 15 minutes, depending on the flow of the event. We will arrange that and let you know the minutes. And after we come back from the breakout rooms, we will continue with the Leonor session. So I had the chance to meet Barry in last Agile Turkey Summit, and also in the last Agile Turkey Summit celebration dinner. He has made something unexpected. All of a sudden, he brings some post-its from his bag with a prepared question list. And in the celebration dinner, we all started to write answers to those questions. It was a good facilitation for us. It was unexpected and a lot of fun. So I believe today's session will be fun as well. And I'm waiting, very excited. I'm very excited and waiting to hear his surprise guest. So I'm sharing the microphone with Barry and with his surprise guest now. Welcome, Barry and guest.
Yeah, thanks a lot for this introduction. That's very kind of you. Because you're correct, in last October, I attended Agile Turkey with 999 other participants. And my presentation at that time was also about the Zombie Scrum. And now you can imagine, like, oh, is he going to give the same presentation? No, it is about the Zombie Scrum. But in October, it was about liberating structures as one of the antidotes to Zombie Scrum. My assumption is that right after my presentation, every one of you started using liberating structures and gaining more experience. And therefore, you are ready for this presentation, because you could consider this as a follow-up presentation. This one will be about Zombie Scrum and the number one strategy to prevent or fix it. I thought this was kind of a catchy title to do this presentation about. I guess we have a surprise host, so maybe this is also the moment for the person that I invited also to join to introduce himself.
Yeah, sure. This is Christian Verwijs, Barry's colleague at the Liberators, and I'm very happy to be here. Wasn't initially planning because I had some family commitments, but we were able to move those around so that I was able to attend. So it's very nice to be here and talk about this.
Now the entire company, the Liberators, is present in this call.
Yes.
So let's get started. And maybe, first of all, I don't really know how much time this talk is going to take. Initially, I was like, oh, okay, 10 minutes should be fine, maybe 15 minutes. And then I was creating this presentation and I was like, okay, it could also easily become a 45-minute presentation. And now Christian has joined as well. Christian often also has some interesting things to share. So let's just see what we end up with. Our goal roughly is to do a 15-minute presentation, maybe 20 minutes, and then still give each of you the opportunity to ask some questions. So I think roughly in total, this session will take about 40 minutes. The purpose that we have with this presentation is, on one hand, to briefly reiterate what Zombie Scrum is about. We already created quite a lot of content about it, did a presentation about it. So we're not gonna repeat it again, but we will include some of the findings that we've learned while writing the book. Because yes, Christian, Johannes Schartau, our friend from Germany, and myself are currently writing the book about Zombie Scrum. And we want to give you a taste of the things that we've learned while writing the book so far. And we will introduce the concept of strategy not working. Maybe already good to know is that we will share this entire presentation, including all the links to articles that are relevant for you to know, with the organizers of this event. And they will most likely share it with you as well, so that you can just, in your own pace, study all the material if it proves to be going too fast. Christian, do you have anything to add to this part?
No, you've done an excellent job at starting.
Cool. So also to set the expectation, what Christian and I agreed upon is that I will most likely take the initiative of this presentation, because that's a bit easier, because Christian and I are also not sitting in the same place. And I'll involve Christian whenever I think that it's useful for him to involve. So that will be quite often. So first, briefly reiterate what Zombie Scrum is about. And the best way to do it is just show an illustration. Just take a moment for yourself also to just check this this illustration. And maybe for yourself, take a couple of seconds to write down some of the symptoms that you see in this illustration. So I'm gonna give you about 10 till 15 seconds to just in silence study the illustration and see if you can spot some of the symptoms of Zombie Scrum. Go ahead. Okay, that was about 10 seconds. And what you probably have noticed is that some time ago they achieved a Scrum certificate, but there's a spider web already crawling over it. The last retrospective was about 8 years ago. The sprint goal is lacking, or the sprint goal is doing something with Scrum zombies. They haven't got any done software, or they haven't produced any done products. A developer turned out into a zombie Scrum developer, and they are not in contact with any of these stakeholders, or at least they forgot to invite them. That's what we visualize over here. And if you would summarize it, and maybe Chris, can you take this, explain these ones?
Yeah, sure. So the long story short is that zombie Scrum is something that looks like Scrum from a distance. So Scrum teams are doing all the things that you would expect. They have the roles, they have the events, the artifacts. But when you look closer, it's not really alive. And this manifests in four different core symptoms that we identified. The first one is that there's no desire for contact with the outside world. So there are no stakeholders involved, no customers, no users, or very infrequently. There's no working product, no working increment at the end of a sprint to release to production potentially. So there's no way to know if you're going in the right direction. There's also no drive to improve. So even though people see that things are not really working, there are spider webs all over the place and the sprint goal is a zombie instead of an actual sprint goal, there's no drive to improve. There's no drive to make this better, to change things. And finally, there's no autonomy. There's no ownership. Scrum teams don't have ownership of the product that they're working on. Product owners don't have mandate and they cannot even decide about their own composition. So these are the four core symptoms, and we captured those, one of them in the illustration at the bottom, where members of the development team are glad that the stakeholders are gone so they can get back to work.
Yep, cool. So what are the causes of zombie Scrum? And already good to know is that already for over a year, we have created a zombie Scrum survey. Christian is going to explain a bit more about that in a moment. About 1,800 teams have participated in that survey. And the percentages that you see at the end of each sentence are based on the results of that survey. So these are some of the causes that we notice that the community themselves consider as the causes of zombie Scrum. Let's see if it makes sense to read all of them. Maybe just pick a couple of them that we think are very strong causes. One of them is, and that's also the one that resulted in the experiment that we're going to explain in this presentation, is that a lot of teams don't have a clue of why they are doing Scrum. It's something that I explained also in the presentation I gave earlier in October. If you ask them, so why are you doing Scrum? Then it's more like, I don't know, management told us to do Scrum because each organization is doing it nowadays. Or our agile coach told us to do Scrum, or we read a book about Scrum and somehow we ended up doing it. But they don't really know, like, so why are we actually using Scrum? Chris, can you maybe pick another one that you would like to explain?
Yeah, I always like the next one. So teams can't or don't interact with actual stakeholders. And with actual stakeholders, we mean the people that are actually paying for your product or actively using your product. So they actually have a stake in the success of it. And 62% of the teams that we ask report that they rarely or never do this, which is very difficult to do Scrum if you don't know who you're building it for. So that's another example of one of the causes that we've seen.
And maybe also let's pick the third one, because we also visualize that one. What we often see as a cause of zombie Scrum is that there is a huge gap between business and IT. So instead of really collaborating with each other on a daily basis, it's more like the business sort of like sends the requirements to the IT department and then more like to the IT factory. And the IT factory needs to build the software, and then someday maybe it goes back to the business and probably it's already outdated anymore. It's not relevant anymore. So instead of having a healthy collaboration, they are often, sometimes literally, situated in different buildings and really not collaborating with each other. So these are three of the courses. Like I said, I'm going to share this presentation afterwards. Then you can read the other ones as well. This is just to give you a taste already about the symptoms and the causes of Zombie Scrum. And this is the research team. So this is the three guys that are currently writing the book about Zombie Scrum. Thea Schucke is our visual illustrator, and she tried to sort of like visualize us. By looking at me, I seem to be more like a crook.
She did a great job visualizing us. Mary does not always agree with the way he's illustrated.
Yeah, and we like not to take ourselves too seriously. So my nickname is Dr. Stubble because of my stubble beard. We've got Captain Curly, and we've got Lord Redbeard. That's Johannes Schartau from Germany. Chris, can you maybe tell us about the zombies? Scrum.
So Barry already mentioned that we have the Zombie Scrum Survey Checker. Some of you have probably already given it a try or know it's there. It's been online, I think, since last summer. And it was built because we really wanted to get a sense of what's actually happening with Scrum teams. A lot of people, and that includes Barry and me at some occasions, we say things that sound very obvious, but we don't really know if it's actually the case. So for example, if you do refinement, you're more effective at delivering done increments. That's something that a lot of us say in our community, but is it actually the case? So we wanted to build a platform where Scrum teams can diagnose themselves to see how are we doing with Scrum? Are we maybe doing a little bit of Zombie Scrum or a lot even? Or are we doing a really good job with Scrum? And we wanted to also give teams feedback on their results from the survey. And for ourselves, we wanted to collect data with the survey that we can analyze so that we can start saying more, that we can start saying things that are actually based on data that we have and not just our own opinions or intuitions. And the Zombie Scrum Survey Checker is the platform for that. Barry has included the screenshot of the homepage, part of the homepage. And as you can see, teams can participate. It's a pretty long survey, I think 100 questions. You can choose for a short or a long version. And at the end, you get feedback very detailed on how you did, but also compared to all the other teams in our database. So you can see how you're doing and you get very detailed feedback on it. And it's free. It's anonymous. You don't have to pay anything for it. It's just our way to help Scrum teams. So give it a try.
And I'm going to show an illustration that proves that we've really done some research. And I'm going to give Chris the credit because I don't have a clue how he has done it. But... Oh, let's go to the next one. So, Chris, please.
What do you expect from me? Barry, what do you expect from here? Notice, maybe just we're actually actively analyzing the data right now. We have data from 1,700 teams. We've narrowed it down to 1,200 that we're doing the actual analysis with. We're working together with a university in Denmark, and we're also involving other researchers, like actual scientists, which is cool, I think. And what we're doing is we're trying to research to see what's actually happening in Scrum teams. How does the process work? What helps? What doesn't help? What makes no difference at all? And this picture is just one of the preliminary results that we have. You don't have to look at it too closely because I can imagine it's hard to understand what's going on there. But we'll publish the results in a way more readable format in the near future when our analysis has been confirmed and verified by others. So that's coming up pretty soon, I think.
Yeah. But what we are already doing is that, in a way, the book that we are currently writing, the Zombie Scrum Survival Guide, is unique in the sense that we are including actual data in the book. And the data that we are including results in basically the structure of the book itself and some of the key findings. So we're not going to discuss the book in detail because I see that we've got sort of like 5 minutes left for our time box. But the structure of the book will be an explanation about Scrum and Zombie Scrum. And after that, the four themes that we consider, let's say, the most relevant, the most important. One key part of the book will be to build what stakeholders need. The other part will be ship it fast, improve continuously, and self-organize. Because in a way, build what stakeholders need is that what we've learned is that a lot of Scrum teams that are infected with Zombie Scrum don't really have a clue who their stakeholders are. Often they think that a manager is their stakeholder or maybe even their product owner. And if we are digging a bit deeper in like, but who's actually going to use your product, or who's really attaching value to the product that you're using, then they are looking at you with a look like, sort of like an empty stare or a glazed look. So they don't really know who the stakeholders are. So that's one key part of the book, Build What Stakeholders Need, because that really helps you to validate, like, are we really building the right product? Maybe Chris, can you emphasize or explain a bit like what Ship It Fast is about?
Yeah, Ship It Fast is about, well, what the title says, that you have to ship fast in order to work empirically. That's the whole purpose of Scrum. And in the chapter, we analyze why a lot of teams struggle in that area. But we also, and that goes for all the other area, all the other chapters as well, we offer a lot of practical interventions that you can try. I think the book has over 50 of them in it. Very small things you can do. And we always assume that you're in a position where you can't really change that much, because that's also the case for a lot of zombie Scrum teams. They can't really change a lot. So what can you do in that environment? So that's what we do in the Ship It Fast chapter. You also want me to do the other ones, Barry?
Yeah, man, that might be easy. Yeah.
So improve continuously. What's important is that shipping fast and building what stakeholders need is hard. It's difficult. So you have to improve. And we're going to dig deeper into what actually is necessary for teams to improve continuously, to create a learning organization. And finally, self-organization is relevant because you have to self-organize around all the impediments that get in the way of shipping fast, building what stakeholders need, and continuously improving. So that's what the final chapter of the book will go much deeper into.
Cool. So by now we explained some of the causes, some of the symptoms, and give you a taste of what the book will be about. And I can imagine like, okay, so if I recognize this, how can I fix it? Or if you're like, ooh, I don't really recognize it in my current organization, but I would like to prevent it, how can I do that? So that's what we're going to focus on right now. So like Chris said, the book is packed with experiments, and one of them is going to explain in a way what strategy not working is about. So that's also our recommendation. If you really had to pick one experiment, then I would say host a strategy not working workshop. And just to clarify, that's something that you can just do by yourself. There are some organizations that have experience with organizing a strategy not working workshop, like the people from ACM Agile as well. We have some experience with it as well, but you can also just host your own workshop and just ask for some support with that. We thought this is an interesting quote by Keith McCandles. He's one of the founders of Liberating Structures and Johannes. And it explains in a one-liner what strategy not working is about, because it's an approach for shaping the future while creatively adapting in the moment. And that was a three-second silence to emphasize the awesomeness of this quote. So strategy not working in a way is, it's actually pretty simple, because what you're doing is you are answering these six core questions. You can answer these six core questions in 10 minutes. You can also take a week and explore these questions with each other. I think the most essential part is that if you do it within your organization, and I'm just going to jump to this slide already, is make sure that you involve as many people in your organization as possible from as many different departments as possible as well. So just make sure that strategy is not something that only C-level management is involved with. Make sure that the product owners, the Scrum Masters, the Scrum teams, any relevant supporting departments are involved as well.
Can I add one small thing to what you already mentioned, Barry?
Yeah, go ahead.
So by strategy, we don't necessarily mean the corporate strategy. Strategy is any kind of planning that you do together to be effective at something. So it could be how to work effectively with Scrum. What strategies do you use for that? The product strategy that you're developing. It could also be the corporate strategy. That's what strategy not working is suited for as well. But it's any kind of strategy. You can take it on a really high level or go at a much smaller level for example, a single team.
Yeah, because in a way, strategy is all about putting ideas and ambitions into reality. And it could be like, we have the idea for this product, and that's something that we want to put into reality. It could also be, we have the idea of using Scrum to deal with complexity, and we want to put that into reality in our organization. And that's something that those six questions that you are currently seeing are helping you explore. And by answering those six questions, you can create a strategy to put it into practice. And you can see one question, the first one is more about so the purpose. So why are we even, for example, why are we even using Scrum in our organization? The context is focused on, so what's happening around us that we need to take into account when we are using Scrum. And the other questions are focusing on, so what are the challenges that we are facing? Where are we currently starting in our organization? What is the ambition? What is it that we would like to achieve? And how are we continuously going to inspect and adapt to make sure that Scrum is going to work and is going to keep working in our organization? But this might feel a bit like high level abstract. It's going to stay abstract because so the question might be, so how am I going to answer these questions? Well, of course, by using liberating structures. And what we visualized over here is that there's not really one silver bullet to answer these questions. In total, there are 33 liberating structures, and you can use all of them to answer the six questions. For example, to make it a bit more tangible, if you want to clarify the purpose of why you're using Scrum, then use 9 whys. Or if you want to clarify, so what's the context of our organization, then use critical uncertainties. Yeah. Chris, maybe you also want to pick some.
Or when you're talking about the challenge that you're facing, you can do a conversation cafe. It's the coffee cup icon. To talk about what's keeping us up at night as a team, what's our biggest worry right now, what's happening in the market, what's the challenge that we have to overcome. And you can also look at the baseline. So where are we now? What are the assets that we have? What are the strengths? What are our weaknesses? And you can do that with a liberating structure called what, so what, now what, which is about actually debriefing very structured way what's happening, what people are seeing in their environment. And finally, and Barry can do the last one, ambition. So what are our ambitions for the future? What do we want to make possible? Liberating structure like 25/10 crowdsourcing is really well suited for getting a sense of that very quickly, even in very large groups with hundreds of people.
Yeah. And yeah, the final one is action evaluation. For example, you can create an eco cycle to create transparency about all the activities and all the things that are currently going on, and to make sure to see, okay, so what are the things that are stuck, or what are the things that we need to set in motion? Interestingly, and that's sort of like an epiphany that I had last evening, is that you can use all the Scrum events themselves to explore these steps of a strategy not working. Because if you go back to this one, you could, for example, during the sprint review, have a conversation about, so what's the purpose of our upcoming sprint? You can use the sprint retrospective to reflect on, so what are the challenges that we are facing and what do we need to do? So what are the actions and the evaluations or the steps that we need to take? Even during the daily Scrum, you can continuously evaluate the baseline. So given where we are today, what do we need to do? If we are brutally honest, where are we right now? So you do not need to continuously set up new meetups and new workshops. You can also just use current Scrum events to continuously explore your strategy. Just an epiphany that I wanted to share. Now, I can imagine that you're wondering, like, so, okay, that's a nice story, Christian and Barry, that you're talking about. How does this help me prevent or fix zombie Scrum? Well, the answer is there. Because with strategy not working, everyone is involved and engaged in developing and evolving strategies to make Scrum successful on all levels in the organization. And this sort of repeats the message that I already gave earlier in this talk. What we see often in organization is that Scrum is or something that only the teams are doing, or it is something like high-level management had a big agile transformation and a rollout plan, and suddenly people woke up in their new Scrum team and ta-da, they were doing Scrum. And with strategy not working, you can make sure that everyone can be involved in creating a strategy that really makes sure that Scrum can succeed. And like I said, you can just use your current, you can organize a one-day strategy not working workshop as a kickoff, but you can just use your Scrum event continuously to develop and evolve strategies to keep Scrum working in your organization. Chris, anything to add?
No, that's great. Maybe the only thing I can add is that the idea is to do this often and to keep doing this. So strategy not working is not something you do once. It's something you do continuously. And you can spend more time on it or less time on it, but it's a continuous process because then you're actually learning and overcoming these challenges together.
Yep. Let's see if we've got it. I think we already extended our time box with 5 or 10 minutes, but let's see. If you want to read more about strategy not working, we already wrote a couple of articles about them. These are the articles. This is examples of how we used it for our own company, Deliberators. We gave an example of how you can use it within your own Scrum team. Just check it out if you're interested in this topic. This is some promotion about the book that we are writing. And actually, if there's only one benefit from all the COVID stuff that's going on, is that we have a lot of time for writing the book. So maybe, just maybe, the book will already be published by the end of this year. And we've got a network that's free for everyone to join. And currently we are hosting quite a lot of virtual meetups as well as part of the Deliberators network. And if you like what we do, you can always make a donation in a way as well. Cool. I think that's it. Chris, anything to add? Great. So I think this is the part where we give the opportunity to also ask some questions. A question to the organization. Do I need to stop sharing my screen right now or shall I continue? Just keep it on.
You can stop sharing and we can see each other so that during the Q&A session, maybe you could also support the participants. Thank you for this fantastic presentation. And we have a lot of questions in Slido waiting right now, but as the host of the session today, I will take the liberty to ask the first question that I'm wondering. Also, when we go through your articles and other summit talks, etc., I see that sometimes in the organizations, one of the most common reason for the zombie Scrum is the agile coaches. So you mentioned this in one of your talks also. And as an agile coach myself, and I believe there are many agile coaches in the participants and very to be agile coaches. They are in the beginning of their pathway right now in the participants. So I would like to ask that, how can the agile coaches be useful to the organizations without being blockers in the organizations to leading to zombie Scrum so that they will be beneficial for the organization?
Okay, I think Chris and I can both share our view on that one. For me, it's not really about the agile coach themselves. It's more what I strongly believe is that the people doing work, the Scrum teams, should themselves be put in a position in which they can create an environment in which they can be successful. And what I often, a pitfall what might happen, but in a way that you are not fulfilling your agile coaching role like you should fulfill it, is that an agile coach takes away a lot of responsibility and ownership away from the Scrum team. And then you'll get maybe a situation in which the Scrum teams are getting offered a lot of best practices by agile coaches, like, why don't you try user stories? Why don't you try burn down charts to visualize your work? Or I read something about the Spotify model. Why don't we start using that within that organization? And agile coaches are doing that with the best intentions because they want to feel useful as well. But that's not really helpful to many organizations. Let them figure out themselves if user stories are even useful for them, or if using story points are even useful for them, and often they are not. So let them sort of, like, when I was a Scrum Master, I had the opportunity to really have my own Scrum journey in a way that was useful for me. And I learned a lot by just embarking on that journey. And I think, and that can be useful for an agile coach, is be a mentor and be a coach, but really offer the Scrum teams their own learning journey. And then as an agile coach, you can be tremendously useful, but then you are coaching. And what I see happening a lot with agile coaches is that it's not really coaching what they are doing. It's more like supporting these large rollout plans and just keeping the old mindset in place. And then it's not really useful. And Chris, I have another perspective, but I do not want to mow away all the grass already. Maybe you can also explain the pitfall that might happen.
Well, I'm not sure if this is the one you're looking for, but one pattern that we often notice, and Barry and I have fulfilled both the role of Scrum Master and Agile coaches for a long time. But one pattern we often see is that Agile coaches are mostly working on the enterprise level or on the department level, and Scrum Masters are only constrained to their Scrum teams. And that's just not how the role of Scrum Masters is intended. Scrum Masters are there to help the entire organization work empirically. And one question that follows then is, how do you do that? How can one Scrum Master do that? Shouldn't we have people with specialized roles, Agile coaches, for example, for that? And the answer is no. You can have Scrum Masters work together throughout the organization to create networks, to work with product owners, with stakeholders, members of the development teams, to create change across the organization. And if there's one thing that Barry and I are trying to do in all the organizations we do work in, it's to create those networks, but also create those networks across organizations by bringing Scrum Masters and people that are passionate about Scrum together. Is that what you were looking for, Barry?
Yes, that's precisely what I was looking for.
Thank you very much. I think a little bit self-organization and experimentation should be left to the teams. And also the Scrum Masters should be empowered as they are. They also need to serve for the organization as well, other than the team level. So I will continue with the questions in Slido. So the first one is, how can we bring our stakeholders to our reviews, especially if we are an IT team? What are the real motivators for the stakeholders to participate to reviews?
What a great. If anything to mind, Chris, just keep talking, continue talking. I'm giving it some thought.
Well, my first answer is a bit of a direct one, but it's build something that's valuable for them. Then they will show up. Because a lot of the teams, a lot of the successful Scrum teams I've worked in, and some of those were IT teams, or doing back-end stuff for some very difficult, obscure piece of software. But if you build something that's valuable for your stakeholders and they know it and they can actually use it soon after the sprint, they will show up because that's their moment to have to give feedback and to think with you about what else might be helpful for them. However, if you're never releasing anything because everything gets stuck in a staging environment for a year before it goes to production, why should they show up for a sprint review? There's no point, because if they give you feedback, they're going to have to wait a year to use it. So my first answer is to build something that's valuable. I know it's an open door, but it is that simple in a way.
Yeah. And maybe you can also flip the situation, and that is, do not invite your stakeholders and wait for them to show up. As a Scrum team, just go to your stakeholders and just show them what you've created. Because when I worked at a web agency, the stakeholders were like customers somewhere in a different part of the country. So we just rented a van, put all the Scrum team members in the van, and we just drove to the client and just showed them what we created. Because they never showed up. So we just went to them. You can also flip it.
That's a good strategy too, right?
Yeah.
This is good insights. Yeah, maybe also the team check the link with the strategy of the company. Maybe it's not attractive anymore what they are building. So, yeah. So another question is, a business team and an IT team will start Scrum. They have no trust on each other for a long time. We can't build trust in a short time. What are your suggestions?
And they are working in one Scrum team, business and IT, or separate?
Actually, they were in what I understand is they were in different departments, but now they started in the same team after a long time, and there is no trust for a long time. Now, how can we build trust? Because there's always a conflict between business and IT. Now they're in the same team.
Okay. Can I start with this one?
Yeah.
Here?
Yeah.
So one thing I can already tell from the research that we're doing is that trust and safety, psychological safety, are like the most important predictors of successful teams. And this is something that social scientists have known for a long time. So trust is really essential. You have to build that, but you cannot create that in a day. That takes time. I think one of the things you can do, and this is not a silver bullet answer, but many of the liberating structures that are focused on listening and talking openly about your worries, your expectations, the things that you're hoping for, if you do that with your team, over time, you will start building that trust and safety. So Conversation Cafe, it's a very specific liberating structure, is a really good way to build trust in teams. You could use Troika Consulting for it. You could use Wise Crowds. You could use UX Fishbowls. Even 1-2 for all. It doesn't have to be anything fancy. But if you use liberating structures, there's a good chance you can build safety within the team, especially if you have someone who's also looking for to give feedback to people on how they can communicate more effectively and more to create safe environments.
Yeah, and to make the theme of the presentation relevant again, do a strategy not working workshop together with IT and the business. And you don't have to emphasize strategy not working because it's the goal, not the purpose on itself. But create clarification on like, so where are we, what's the baseline? And the baseline might be like, there's not really a tremendously good relationship between business and IT. But if you create transparency about that, then you can have a conversation about it, and then you can define improvements for that as well. So I would recommend simply do a strategy not working workshop together with the people from the business and the people from the IT department.
Yes.
And then use the brain structures that Chris recommended already.
Mm-hmm. I think this is just maybe cascading this strategy networking workshop to even team level, so mm-hmm. that you can create the link about the common purpose, why we are together.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and from that shared purpose, it's much easier to overcome those tensions, because then you have, otherwise you have the IT people who are only concerned with IT, you have the business people only concerned with business, but they're both part of the same company, so they should have a shared purpose. And then you're starting to work from that.
And then you can also do a wicked question. And the wicked question is pretty awesome if you have business and IT, because often they really want to achieve the same end goal, but they might have different preferences. Like IT wants to create the most awesome product ever without having any bugs in technical debt. And the business just wants to have as many features included as possible. So both are fine, but how can we achieve it? How can we make sure that both sides of the wicked questions are respected? Oh, well, just after this call, just do some reading about wicked questions and then you see that it's awesome.
So I think we have around 4 minutes. So I think we can answer last two questions. Let's continue with that. What if you are in an organization where the Scrum Master role is understood as just dealing with the team and not get involved in the things around it?
That's a good question. Maybe it would just, in a way that what I always try to say is the role of a Scrum Master is very simple. It's about creating transparency about what's going on and then inspect and adapt. Maybe that's something that I would recommend in this situation as well. Because my hunch is, if Scrum Masters in the organizations are only focusing on their team, then it will have a often negative consequence of how Scrum is used in the organization. So I would say maybe organize a retrospective or maybe a multi-team retrospective and try to create transparency about, so what's going on? And just don't make it about the Scrum Master role itself. Great transparency about the consequences, and the consequences that are also valuable for other people who are working around the teams themselves. Might feel a bit abstract, but I would like to steer away the conversation from the Scrum Master role itself, because then you'll get a "because the Scrum Guide says so" conversation, and that's not always the most helpful conversation. Try to create transparency about, so what are the consequences of the fact that the Scrum Master is only focusing on the Scrum team, and sort of like develop solutions from there.
Chris? Yeah, so you could very specifically, you could measure cycle time. Is it going down over time when you have Scrum Masters doing their work? Are dependencies with other teams decreasing? Are the number of blockers that teams run into, are they decreasing? Because if Scrum Masters are only focused on their team, as Barry says, it's unlikely that that will improve over time. It will either get worse or stay the same. So as a Scrum Master, you can use metrics like that to show what's not happening, because you cannot fulfill your role as it is intended in the Scrum Guide, even though I agree with Barry's caution to start focusing on what the Scrum Guide says.
I think I agree with you, and I think in the organizations, sometimes doing the regular kind of tunnel retrospectives works, so that whether we are on the, in the both way of work works well for us or what didn't work well. So other than the team level, it helps. Okay, we should add this kind of mechanisms that can help us, or this kind of responsibilities we should take on to make this better work. Yes. So last question, for the sake of the time, not all the developers willing to take responsibility of the product success. They just want to do their job as written in task description. How to fix this?
Chris, you've been a developer, Chris. Do you recognize it?
Or? Yes, very much. Actually, I even recognize it now when I'm doing development. I'm like, just let me develop, please, Barry. I don't want to have a meeting now. Let me write code. I would say just let them. If it's not the entire development team, just work with the developers that do want to expand their role. I've worked with many developers over my years, and it's a lot of fun. Some of them are more open to trying new things. Focus on the people that are eager to learn new things, to go to customers, to talk to users, to do something that is outside of their role. There are always going to be people, and that is not only for developers, that goes for any role, that prefer to do the work that's part of their role, because that's what they feel comfortable with. They may be uncertain about their ability to do something that's a bit outside of what they usually do, and they're afraid of failing in that, and maybe feeling ashamed of that when they fail. So just accept that that's the case and work with the people that do want to do it. That creates safety for the other people to jump in later, because that's what I've usually seen happen in that case.
And I agree. I think, but that's also the case of what we explained earlier, like involve the teams and the developers themselves in creating a way of working that really is helpful for themselves. And eventually, it might not be from day one, but eventually you always end up with like, okay, let's don't postpone releasing our products too long, because then we don't know if we're building the right product. And so for whom are we actually building this product? So let's go search for the stakeholder. And they probably also figure out that what they've chosen is not like the perfect way of working yet. So let's build in some opportunities for reflection as well. And then you end up with a print retrospective. So just, and then the way that it evolves, if it evolves like that, then they might end up with something that looks like Scrum, might also be Kanban, but then it's really their way of working that they've created and they've chosen themselves. And I believe that that approach is sort of like the approach that I prefer the most.
I think also all of these approaches are applicable to the teams, non-IT teams. It doesn't have to be a software developer, but in many Scrum teams, this role description, being stuck in the role description, happens because of the old habits, but we can apply all these approaches to the all kinds of, sometimes the marketing person with the marketing background tends to do the same thing. I know marketing, I do only the marketing part of the work, but I think all applicable for all of them, these.
Right. Yeah.
So I think we are at the end of our time box. So thank you very much for this lovely presentation and your insights to the questions, the answers to the questions. Now we will be doing this networking session before I'm leaving the microphone to my beloved friend Esra. We will have a 15-minute networking break, which we will be disbanded to the Zoom breakout rooms, just to know each other and share experiences. So don't be shy, just say hello and see how the conversation goes. So my friends are now organizing. If you don't want to join, you can press the don't accept button so that you can stay in the main room as well. Okay, ready.
So one more thing to add, Melike. First of all, thank you very much for your efforts for this great session. So please do not use the leave meeting button just at the end of the breakout rooms, because sometimes there could be a misunderstanding about it. So thanks to Zoom, it will automatically bring you back to the main room just at the end of the this networking session. So I also would like to congratulate the people, the luckiest people who are going to be in the rooms with Barry and Christian. So now I'm starting the breakout rooms. Enjoy the networking break for 15 minutes.
Thank you.